your presence as broken vessels, seeking to be filled. Lord, we lift your name on high. We come to praise your holy name. We come to sit in our tent doors to see what thus saith the Lord. Have your way in this place. Oh God, we thank you now for what you have done, what you are doing, and what you're going to do. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray and give thanks. Let us say amen, amen. As we hold to God's unchanging hand, we know that time is still for swift transition. Thank you. the Old Testament reading. Coming from Psalms, Dr. Johnny Hopkins, is that right? Amen.
Good morning, Queen Street.
Good morning.
I'll be reading from Psalms chapter 8. Psalms chapter 8. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is thy name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of your children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies, to silence the foe and your dominion. When I consider the heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them? You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet, all flocks and herds, and the animals of the wild, the birds in the sky, and the fish in the sea, all that swim in the paths of the sea. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is thy name in the whole earth. Who am I that you even think about me? Who am I? God bless you.
For you in heaven. This is how the prophets who lived before you were persecuted. The word of God for the people of God. God bless the word. It is prayer time.
Let's pray. Our Father God, who art in heaven, God who sits high and looks low, who sees and knows all about us, you know about our conditions, our situations, you know our coming, Lord, and you know our going. You know all of our needs and all of our wants, even before we ask. It is in that name of Jesus Christ now that we once more and again we come before you with thanksgiving, humble hearts. Thank you, Lord, for the many, many blessings that you send us daily. Thank you, Lord, for your unmerited mercy, your amazing grace. Thank you for your great faithfulness toward us. And you've been faithful, Lord, down through the years. You've looked beyond our many faults, and you saw and you fixed and filled all of our needs. Lord, you've been our dwelling place through the raging storms of this life. You've been our bridge over the confusions and the trouble and the superfluities of this world, in spite of ourselves. Lord, we come confessing our sins and our shortcomings, our sins of commission, of those things we shouldn't have done, our sins of omission, those things that we should have done. We acknowledge, O Lord, our lack of redeeming values. And we pray for your forgiveness and ask that you would purge our hearts and our spirits from all unrighteousness. We ask you to help us, Lord, to examine ourselves daily so we can see ourselves as you see us. So we might not think more highly of ourselves than we ought to. Help us, Lord, to put on the full armor of Christ so as not to be defiled and deceived by the evil one of this world. We pray, Lord, that you would visit your Holy Spirit upon us and cause everything that we do, say, sing, and preach during this wishing experience, that it will be pleasing to you, and cause everyone that see and hear us to see you in us. We're truly thankful, Lord, for this day of life. We're thankful for reasonable health, sufficient food, clean water, and shelter. We're thankful for our church family, our friends. We thank you most of all for your son, Jesus the Christ, and that old rugged cross that made it all possible, and to put us right with you, God, forever. I pray your blessings on each member of our church, and I ask that you would grant all that you know that they stand in need of. Bless, Lord, our leadership with a special portion. And we lift up those less fortunate than ourselves, those who are stressed out, sick, shut in, shut out, jailed. You know who they are, you know where they are. Those who are bereaved, Lord, for all of the shootings and all of the violence and all of the things that are going on in this world. And then we, Lord, we ask you lift up
our youth and our young adults. Let them know, Lord, that they too must set their house in order, and they must give an account of their deeds. Then, Lord, we pray that you would visit your Holy Spirit in our homes, our communities, our neighborhoods, our schools, and ask you to fix those things, Lord, that are broken down. You know what they are. Attitudes, relationships, fix hearts and minds in our youth. Help us, O Lord, to teach them that no good thing will be withheld from those who accept God in faith and believe that He is. Now, Lord, we lift up and pray for your blessings upon those who are faithful to give their resources, their finances, to support this mission and the ministry and the vision of this church. They're faithful, Lord, and they contribute, and you have blessed them, and we are thankful for them. These, Lord, are our prayers, our supplications, and we ask them in Jesus' name, that matchless, that miraculous name, the only one that matters. Amen.
Thank you. Amen. Do we have any visitors, any guests in the house? If you would stand, we want to recognize you. Come on, Sister Laverne, Brother Austin, good to see you, our New York member. Amen. Good to see you. Good to see you. All right. Before the praise dancers come out, I want to ask Sister Alexis if you could come and share with us. I know you have a brief announcement regarding the Baptist General Convention, regarding the children's home. And she's just going to share briefly, and then I know that we can make information available for the entire congregation at a later date.
Amen. Good morning, everyone. Pastor, pulpit associates, music ministry, officers, members, and friends, I am before you very briefly. I thank you once again, all of you who were participating in the annual session. I trust that you had a blessed time. I did. Very, very briefly. The Baptist General Convention, along with the Virginia Baptist State Convention, which is the other Black Baptist Convention in Virginia, support and own a children's home. This is the 75th year that we have owned that home and that property. And that property is 260 acres of prime land. It was purchased, as one of our previous presidents explained at the convention, by our ancestor Sadie Pence. And at this time, the bank has called the loan due. So we are asking, both conventions are asking, I am asking that you would prayerfully consider contributing to the to funding to pay off that loan. There will be specific information available in the church office next week. The current president has asked for each church and each pastor to make a specific donation, which is very, very doable. The current amount due is $1.2 million. And if I would share, if you don't mind, Pastor, when we look at this land, if the bank were to take it, they would sell it off for hundreds of times that. And this is owned by us, for our children in greatest need. So please keep that in mind. I will be back with more information about it. We have until October, and all of the member churches of both conventions are committed to making this payment. Just so that you are aware, please be prayerful, keep it in mind, and I will share more. Thank you.
Thank you, Alexis, and I would ask that we would govern ourselves accordingly. It is a vital part of the Baptist General Convention, the Baptist Children's Home. When I served as pastor up in Stanton, I can recall we had a troubled young man. His great aunt was taking care of him, but she found herself at a point at which she could no longer handle him. And so we ended up visiting the Baptist Children's Home in Ettrick, and ended up enrolling him there. And it ended up really being a life-changing experience for him. And so if there's anything that we can do as a church body and as a convention, we seek to do that. Amen?
Amen?
All right, adoration and praise, come on and share with us.
Thank you.
sermonic text this hour comes from Luke's Gospel, chapter 10, beginning in verse 29. Luke chapter 10, beginning at verse 29. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, "Who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down the road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him. And when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to a man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." And Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." God's word for the people of God, all praises be to God. Thank you. can't stop.
Those who persecute you. And that is counter culture.
So these 70 went out, and they returned celebrating the success of their mission. There was the obvious evidence of their having made a difference in the hamlet and homes in which they freely shared God's word. God's word, elder, will make a difference. And when they got ahead of themselves, Deacon West, and wanted to treat the Lord's doing as their own success, Jesus had to check them and remind them of their kingdom priorities. It's not about the submission of demonic forces. It's not about the numbers on your membership roster. It's not about the likes or followers that you have. It's not about if you slayed the folk on Sunday morning. The priority, my sister, the priority, my brother, is that your name is transcribed by the blood of Jesus and the Lamb's Book of Life. Is your name on the roll? Now, that's one side. Now, the other event that immediately follows our sermonic text is Jesus' visit to the home of friends Mary and Martha. We see a hospitable Martha welcomes Jesus into her home and then works diligently preparing the food that will make him comfortable. You can imagine, Deacon West, that she's running back and forth into the kitchen, making sure that the smothered chicken and pot roast is just right. She's got some collard greens with smoked turkey wings simmering, some macaroni and cheese and cornbread in the oven. And you know, you gotta have some sweet iced tea that's ready. Amen, say amen, somebody. Now, meanwhile, Sister Mary welcomes Jesus with her presence. She's not doing anything else. She gives the Master her undivided attention and listens to his every word. Well, since we are focused on better this year, it's worth noting when you read the text that Jesus commends Mary as saying she offers the better part. Not negating Martha's attentiveness and radical hospitality, but Martha is worried and distracted by many things, and Mary has chosen the better part because she has chosen to simply be in the presence of the Lord. The provision for physical sustenance is good, but what Jesus really wants is us. He wants our hearts. Well, beloved, come here and see that in between the two narratives is a parable. Jesus shares about 24 parables in Luke's gospel. A parable is a relatable story, utilizing the familiar and cultural particularities of the listeners. It was a down-to-earth story with holy and heavenly meaning. He used parables, similar to the way our enslaved ancestors used spirituals. They endured unimaginable hardship, cruelty, and brutality. And in the midst of it all, they sang songs like, steal away. Steal away, steal away to Jesus. Steal away home. I ain't got long to stay here. Or even the way Public Enemy protested racial injustices with its Do the Right Thing hip-hop classic, you know, Fight the Power. Yet our best trained, best educated, best equipped, best prepared troops refuse to fight. As a matter of fact, it's safe to say that they would rather switch than fight. They said, we've got to fight the powers that be. Like the cultural connectedness and nitty-grittiness of hip-hop, like a West African reel, Jesus used parables to meet people where they were and then point them to the transcendent reality of where they could be. I'm talking about a new life, a repentant life, to kingdom living. One day, a man comes up to Jesus and he wants to raise vital questions about life. At some point, he wants to trick Jesus and show him that he knows a little more than Jesus knows. Can you imagine trying to one-up Jesus? He was trying to elevate himself out by putting Jesus down. You know how some folk can get. But instead of turning it into a theological or philosophical debate, Jesus pulls the man's query from midair and places it on a dangerous curve, somewhere between Jerusalem and Jericho. Jesus tells the parable, the story of the Good Samaritan, to convey a message about how we are to treat one another, including our enemies. So come here and see in the first instance that Jesus admonishes us to demonstrate compassion. Compassion. Listen. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell in the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and took off, leaving him half dead. Now, by chance, a churchgoer was going down that road on his way to the 10 o'clock service. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a minister or a deacon, not sure which one. Don't know. But when he came to the place where he saw him, he passed by on the other side so that he would not have to meet eyeball to eyeball with the man who was hurt and helpless. But someone wearing a MAGA hat and who didn't appear to attend anybody's church, while traveling, came upon him. And when he saw him, he was moved with compassion. Look, I'm going to edit this on the fly. Maybe the man who is down there, beat up, maybe he's wearing the MAGA hat. I think that'll make it a little bit more relatable. Just go with me. So Jesus, he stripped religious folk of their race, religiosity and churchiness, and adorned authentic kingdom of God spirituality on the least likely individual to help in this situation. It's implied that the wounded man is a Jew. And while you would think a fellow Jew or a devoutly religious Jew would help another Jew, that's not what happens. It turns out that it is a Samaritan, the one who would have nothing to do with the Jews, who ends up doing something. We could say that someone from another race is the one who helps. Someone from another neighborhood, the other side of the tracks, even another political party. Someone who is different. And we know that different does not mean deficient. He sees the wounded and has compassion. Compassion is recognizing the suffering of others and then taking action to help. Compassion embodies a tangible expression of love for those who are suffering. Someone said, compassion is sometimes the fatal capacity for feeling what it is like to live inside somebody else's skin. It is the knowledge that there can never really be any peace and joy for me until there is peace and joy finally for you too. There's an African saying, I am because we are, and we are because I am. Compassion. Compassion is one of those words in the Bible that's best understood by showing us what it looks like. The writer of Proverbs 31, he says, speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and the needy. 1 John tells us, dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and in truth. This is what the Lord Almighty said, administer true justice, show mercy and compassion to one another. Do not oppress the widow or the fatherless, the foreigner or the poor. Do not plot evil against one another. The Apostle Paul said to the Philippians, therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of mind. Compassion. We see Jesus extends compassion to helpless crowds, compassion to sick folk, hungry folk. Jesus was leaving Jericho. He had compassion for two blind men who cried out for his mercy. Jesus said, well, what do you want me to do? They said, let our eyes be opened. We want to see again. Jesus was moved with compassion and touched their eyes, and they regained their sight, and they followed him. Compassion. But come here and see in the second instance that Jesus also shares the story, the parable of the Good Samaritan, to show us what compassion should do. Yeah. Compassion should lead to involvement. That's the second move, involvement. In other words, you do something. It's right here in the text. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, treating them with oil and wine, and then he put him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. You see, we are called to do something and not pass by on the other side. Some years ago, someone made a critical assessment of the church by rewriting the great hymn, Onward Christian Soldiers. And in his assessment, he wrote, backward Christian soldiers, fleeing from the fight, with the cross of Jesus nearly out of sight. Christ, our rightful master, stands against the foe, onward into battle, we seem afraid to go. He said, like a mighty tortoise moves the church of God. Brothers and sisters, we are treading where we have always trod. We are much divided, many bodies weave. We have different doctrines, but not much charity. Backward Christian soldiers, fleeing from the fight with the cross of Jesus, nearly out of sight. I've got to admit, Deacon Annie, I don't know that author's heart or perspective, but I can tell you that that's not the church of yesterday or today. Laverne, that is not the kingdom community which Jesus spoke of in Luke 4. That's not the church community that he spoke of in Matthew 25. That's not the church for which he gave his life. That's not the church that was birthed and empowered when the day of Pentecost had come and they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. That's not the church that Luke described in Acts when he said all who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. That's not the same church. That's not the church, particularly predominantly African-American church. It's not the church that I know. In the parable, in the story, the man gets down from his beast. He decided not to be compassionate by proxy, not to simply stroke a check to ease his guilt, but he got down with him. He administered first aid and he helped the man in need. That's what the church has done, and that's what the church continues to do every day. The church serves as the center of the community. The church offers spiritual comfort. And the church offers a sense of community and fellowship and somebody-ness for all of God's children. The church offers moral guidance. The church offers help for the needy, for those who are trying to pay their bills, those who are trying to make ends meet, for those who need some food in their cupboards. The church teaches practical job and life skills. The church offers a sense of racial affirmation. The church is not partisan, but it is political, because it speaks truth to power. The church, God's people are called to get involved in the community. Even during a pandemic, we can see churches involved in communities and transforming lives. We have work to do as an intergenerational church, but we are still on the battlefield for the Lord. But we're still the church. We just recognize all of our students. We continue to give out scholarships, helping hands is distributing grab bags and meals to go. The food pantry is giving out food. We just offered an emergency preparedness clinic. We're the church. We're in talks with Santara Hospital right now to offer a mobile health clinic here at Queen Street. Our substance abuse program is almost ready to restart. The city of Norfolk wants us to host another financial literacy program. The church is here, and the church is at work. The church is called to be a blessing on every avenue, including Brambleton Avenue in the end. But come here and see in the final instance that this involvement or engagement, it leads to sacrifice. Compassion, involvement, and sacrifice. Now this parable that I'm sharing, Dr. Martin Luther King, he shared this parable in his speech, "I've Been to the Mountaintop." Some of you recall the speech. He was considering, when he shared this parable, Dr. King was considering the circumstances and situation surrounding the wounded man and those who pass him by on the road. Jesus doesn't add those details into the story. And so we're left to use our own sanctified imagination. We can fill in the blanks, because Jesus tells us succinctly that a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and took off, leaving him half dead. Dr. King concluded that it is possible that those men were afraid, and that's why they did nothing. Maybe there are moments, beloved, when we find ourselves fettered with fear, handcuffed to helplessness, and so we do nothing. King said the Jericho Road is a dangerous road. It's a winding, meandering road, that it's really conducive for ambushing. He said that you start out in Jerusalem, which is about 1,200 feet above sea level. And by the time you get down to Jericho, 15 or 20 minutes later, you're then about 2,200 feet below sea level. That sounds like a dangerous road. In the days of Jesus, it came to be known as the Bloody Pass. And you know, it is possible that the priest and the Levite looked over that man on the ground and wondered if the robbers were still around. Maybe they had stripped him and beat him, leaving him half dead. Or it is possible that they felt the man on the ground was merely faking it. that he was acting like he had been robbed and hurt in order to seize them over and lure them into a trap and then beat them and rob them from all they have. And so it is possible that the first question that the priest asked, the first question that the Levite asked was, if I stop to help this man, what will happen to me? King said, but then the Good Samaritan comes by. And he imagines that he reverses the question. If I do not stop to help this man, what will happen to him? That's a relevant question for the church. And a relevant question for every believer and follower of Jesus Christ. If I do not stop to help, what will happen? As we were making our way to church today, we saw a car that had gone off the side of the road and was down in a ravine. I said, Luke, we've got to turn around. If we do not stop, what will happen to him? We don't know the circumstances of that car accident, but we felt compelled. We had to stop. Now that's the question that every believer has got to ask. What will happen if I don't stop? What will happen if I don't speak up? What will happen if I don't speak truth to power? What will happen if I don't contribute my gifts? What will happen if I don't lend a hand? What will happen if I don't preach? If I don't teach? If I don't serve? If I don't sing? If I don't usher? If I don't do my part? What will happen? Now, Dr. King shared the parable. On April 3rd, 1968, at the Church of God in Christ headquarters, he was in Memphis to march with striking sanitation workers. He had compassion, and he felt the need to be there, to get involved in their condition. And you know, the following day, April 4th, 1968, he was tragically killed by an assassin's bullet. That's the ultimate sacrifice. No greater love have any man or woman than to lay down his life, her life, for them. The man in the parable paid the price when he took the wounded man to the inn. Read it when you get a chance. He also said that he would be back to take care of any additional debt. In other words, he's coming back. Following Jesus is about sacrifice. It's about loving our neighbor with godly love. That's how you inherit eternal life. We're here today because of those who sacrificed for us and before us. Oh, I know, Alexis, that we are Baptists. But before the Anabaptist movement, as Otis Moss pointed out, there was John Calvin. And before John Calvin, there was Martin Luther. And before Martin Luther, there was St. Thomas Aquinas. And before St. Thomas Aquinas, there was Augustine. And before Augustine, there was Tertullian. And before Tertullian, there was Cyprian. And before Cyprian, there was Paul. And before Paul, there was Peter. Before Peter, there was Jesus. Before Jesus, there was John. Before John, there was Isaiah. Before Isaiah, there was Solomon. Before Solomon, there was David. Before David, there was Saul. Before Saul, there was Samuel. Before Samuel, there was Samson. Before Samson, there was Deborah. Before Deborah, there was Joshua. Before Joshua, there was Moses. Before Moses, there was Joseph. Before Joseph, there was Isaac. Before Isaac, there was Abraham. Before Abraham, there was Noah. Before Noah, there was Cain and Abel. Before there was Cain and Abel, there was Adam and Eve. And before Adam and Eve, there was God in the beginning. planet. God got involved and came down to us through the lineage of David. He came to us as Jesus Christ. He is the Son of Man, but he's also the Son of God. The church's one foundation is Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. And from heaven he came and sought her to be his holy bride. With his own blood he bought her, and for his life he died. I tell you, he gave the ultimate sacrifice on Calvary, on an old rugged cross. He died, he died, he died, but God raised him. God raised him from the grave. Oh my goodness, show compassion. Get involved, stay involved, give sacrificially for yourself. Jesus said, vistas of time. Go. Go and do likewise. Go, Deacon Robinson. Do likewise. Go, Miss Connie and Maggie. Do likewise. Go. Go, Joyce. Do likewise. Bruce and Carmen, go. Deacon Joy, go. Miss Land, go. Deacon Boyd, go. Go, go, Miss Geraldine, go. Adoration and praise, go, 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 go. Go. And do likewise. Amen. Over the house. We want to go ahead and extend the invitation. There may be someone here today. You wish to step out. You want to go be a follower of Jesus Christ, the one who sacrificially gave his life for you and for me. Oh, the invitation is extended. Now is the time. Is there one? From this place, we know Vacation Bible School is coming up. Make sure you look on the My Queen Street website. Make sure you look at our YouTube channel. We've got information regarding Vacation Bible School. We will get that information out regarding the Baptist Children's Home, because the home needs our help. All right, we've got to do something. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace. Amen.